Good morning. We want to welcome you this morning to Hope First Baptist Church. Thank you for joining us here. Thank you for joining us through the video. And we just come this morning on this beautiful day to worship our Lord and Savior. Couple quick announcements. This Thursday, 11 o'clock in the morning, is the Hauser Senior Luncheon here. Sarah, you good? Everything's good. So thank you for bringing the supplies. Thank you for helping with that. Next Sunday is the last Sunday that we will be collecting supplies to take out to Westport Camp. So if you remember, please bring those in next Sunday, and we'll see that they get out there to camp shortly after that. Will you join me in prayer this morning? Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you once again that we can come and worship together as one body in you, to lift up your name in song and in word. We thank you, dear Lord, for this church family that gathers around us in times of trouble, dear Lord. We thank you for this church family that joins with us when we celebrate. We thank you this morning for our pastor and for his family. We thank you, dear Lord, for blessing them in their travels and enjoying family together and birthdays. We thank you that they're home safely and ready to work again for you. We thank you for Stephen for stepping up today and bringing your word to us. We know, dear Lord, that you have already given him your words. We ask that you would speak those words through him, that he may teach us, that we may learn from you. We thank you, dear Lord, for the answered prayers we have already seen, for those mercies that you have showered us with. We thank you, dear Lord, for those prayers, the answers to prayers that we have not yet seen. Dear Lord, we just give you the praise for whatever that outcome may be. We lift up to you those today that are suffering, those that are going through mental anguish, dear Lord. We just ask that you would comfort them, that you would give them courage, encouragement, dear Lord, that they may find the path toward you, that they may see a light. Dear Lord, we pray for those that are struggling with health issues. We pray for Janelle this morning. We pray for Grace and Bryson this morning. We pray for Brody this morning. We pray for others, dear Lord, that need your hand of care placed upon them. This morning, dear Lord, we pray for Chris and Jessica as they go to court once again, dear Lord. We have seen your miracles, your hand being placed upon them already. We call upon that once again, dear Lord, that things would go according to your purpose. They are calm and patiently waiting on you. Their peace rests with you, dear Lord. We just praise you in the outcome, that you may be glorified. Dear Lord, now as we come to you and join with the angels in worship, we just ask that you would be blessed as we lift our hearts and our voices to you in song. In your precious name we pray. Amen. In the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 7, we read, "From that day the ark was lodged at Kiriath-Jearim. A long period of time passed, some 20 years, and all the house of Israel lamented after the Lord. And Samuel said to all the house of Israel, 'If you are returning to the Lord with your heart, then put away the foreign gods, the Ashtaroth, from among you, and deliver your heart to the Lord, and serve him only, and he will deliver you out of the hands of the Philistines.' So the people of Israel put away the Baals and the Ashtaroth, and they served the Lord only. Then Samuel said, 'Gather all Israel at Mizpah, and I will pray to the Lord for you.' So they gathered at Mizpah and drew near water and poured it out before the Lord and fasted on that day and said there, 'We have sinned against the Lord.' And Samuel judged the people of Israel at Mizpah. Now when the Philistines heard that the people of Israel had gathered at Mizpah, the lords of the Philistine went up against Israel. And when the people of Israel heard it, they were afraid of the Philistines. And all the people of Israel said to Samuel, "Do not cease to cry out to the Lord our God for us, that he may save us from the hands of the Philistines." So Samuel took a nursing lamb and offered it as a whole burnt offering to the Lord. And Samuel cried out to the Lord for Israel, and the Lord answered him. As Samuel was offering up the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to attack Israel. But the Lord thundered with a mighty sound, and that day the Philistines threw them into the confusion, and they were routed before Israel. And the men of Israel went out from Mizpah and pursued the Philistines and struck them as far below as Beth Kar. Then Samuel took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shin and caused its name Ebenezer, for he said, "Till now the Lord has helped us." So the Philistines were subdued and did not enter again into the territory of Israel. And the hand of the Lord was against the Philistines all the days of Samuel. The cities that the Philistines had taken from Israel were restored from Ekron to Gath. Israel delivered their territory from the hand of the Philistines. And there was peace also between Israel and the Amorites. So this morning, would you stand with us as we raise our hearts and songs and voice to God?
Thank you. express how much you deserve.
I will clear.
Yeah.
I were. Good? No. Okay. I'm gonna get this. Larry, I'm gonna use your stool. I might not. I might be up. I might be moving around. I have a hard time. I'm telling you, I have a hard time. I even have a standing desk at school, and I'm typing standing up. So.
Today is the moment you've all been waiting for. So this is either going to go, it's going to go one of two ways, because let me tell you, for having no actual legitimate schooling the past week, now that I-STEP testing was all over, last week was one long and exhausting week. And I thought I was going to have time that I did not have. And so this was hastily put together. And so you either will be in luck, and I will have very little to say on these notes I have, and you'll be out much earlier than we usually are. Or I will get loquacious. Where's Jamie? Jamie's not here. What the? I had all these big words for Jamie, and now I hope he's watching. Anyway, I will try not to be loquacious, but I just may, and so you may have to get out late. We don't know. That's up to the Lord right now. So, and Sarah, where are you sitting now? You got Google out, Sarah?
Dictionary.com.
Okay, I promised Jamie that I would use a lot of big words just for him. And so if you're ever in doubt as to what one of my words means, you just feel free to get out Google and look it up. I will try not to be sesquipedalian, but it may not happen, okay? You figure it out. Sesquipedalian. That's right. No. Hey, Siri, what does sesquipedalian mean? Hey, Siri, what's this fool talking about? All right. No, but today, I wanted to, I didn't know for the better part of the week what the heck I was going to talk about today. Dennis, first of all, this has been a plot from the very beginning. You said you weren't going to be here. It was a lie the whole time. Just to get me up here. Uh-huh, yeah. I didn't know what I was going to talk about, and so he suggested springboard off of something I had done for one of my devotionals in the staff meetings, and so it started off like that, and then it turned into this, and it turned into that, and it morphed into what it is now. I just started bouncing different places, and I finally landed on this, but if you attended the business meeting that past Wednesday, you would remember perhaps what I talked, unless you had the memory of my middle schoolers, you would remember what I talked about. I mentioned in John, First John, where he talks about Jesus being born of the blood and of the spirit and of the water, right? And the water he's talking about is birth water, is the stuff that breaks before childbirth. And that was the focus of my talk there. And I kind of want to run with that theme of Jesus' humanity, because it's important that we understand Christ's humanity as much as we do his divinity. over and against either this secular worldview where he was just a man who lived and he was a rabbi in Palestine, then he died, and that's the end of the story. And against this sort of pop culture idea where he's this weird, you know, he's just this stoic, beautiful, angelic man who just he just floats in the air. And I especially love Aryan Jesus, you know, the one where, you know, blonde, big flowing Viking-like blonde beard, you know, white as you or me, you know, and yeah, just like a good ancient Hebrew would be, right? So it's especially important, I think, that we understand what Christ's humanity means. And I rolled with that, and I am where I am today, so I'm just letting the Lord speak today. Anyway, so Robert J. Lifton. Now he was a psychologist, and this is typical genius. Okay, he was enrolled at Cornell at the age of 16. Right, yeah, that's right. He was an Ivy Leaguer at the age of 16 and then went to psychological school 2 years later. Right, and now you see pictures of this guy. It looks like Einstein's cousin, right? He's got the hair of a psychologist, everything. And he was a big time pioneer in the study of the mind. And this isn't an exact quote, but this is an idea that he sort of pioneered and that is basically accepted in the psychological world. He says, most neuroses, you got that? Neuroses, okay, you might have to look that up, okay. Most neuroses people deal with result from a deep feeling of guilt without any clear origin. That lack of identifiable origin is the impetus for much of the anxiety that we are seeing across our culture today. People who know they're guilty. They feel it, but they don't know why. They can't put their finger on it. And so here's a rhetorical question for you, because we know the answer. Has anyone ever experienced the relief of a long-awaited correct diagnosis? I know there are some people in the room who have been through a trial, and I know people, they've had pain, they don't know what it is, they cannot, and that everything that the doctors try, it doesn't work, right? And they go for years with different tests, this and that, I can never find out what it is. And that is deflating. But what is absolutely inflating is when they say, well, let's try this, and then you find out what's actually wrong with you. And if they can treat it, it's the best thing that's ever happened to you. But if they finally identify what it is and say, there's no known cure, that is potentially the most deflating and spirit-breaking thing to hear. And the good news for us is we don't have that kind of diagnosis in Scripture. We know we can be told exactly what is wrong. And there is, believe it or not, a cure. Now, just take a look around us, okay, in the world, that is. I mean, you can do it in here too, but it doesn't take a psychoanalytical mind to see that the world is a messed up place. Amen? Yeah. And we can't fix it. Now, this is something some people struggle with, because people have tried various methods to create utopia on Earth and try to circumvent all the problems that we have, and it has not worked so far. People who have lived in Russia in the past century understand that. People who live in where Al-Qaeda is a threat, they understand this. People who have to deal with the paramilitaries in South America, they know what this is like. It does not work. We cannot fix our problem, but it seems we are keenly aware of it. Right? Some of us, anyway. Even Freud, I'm all about the psychologists today. Even Dr. Sigmund Freud, who I would not recommend as your personal life coach, this is a direct quote. The innermost self is a positive hell. The impulses subjected to repression are those of selfishness and cruelty, which can be summed up in general as evil. Now, like I said, I wouldn't recommend Freud to get most, I mean, even in the psychological world. He may be the father of psychology, but his theory, and he's honored as that, but his theories are not sort of, they've moved on from those. Right? And you can be glad of that because every guy's got an Oedipal complex and stuff like that. It's nonsense. But it seems even Dr. Freud himself has a more accurate view of humanity than many people walking around in the world today. And the Bible, believe it or not, I believe it, has something to say exactly about that. But the bad news is worse than we thought. But, big but, the good news is better than we could have imagined or contrived for ourselves. So it's that bad news that I want to talk about today, as well as the good news, because if I just told you the bad news, you'd all go home in despair. But we are not to walk away from Scripture in despair. So it's that I want to deal with today. So we can look around. If you've lived in the past 2 years in the United States, you know the world is a messed up place. So what is wrong? What is wrong? Let's get a diagnosis going here so we can see if there's any probable cure. And this is where I want to take you in Scripture today, at page the first, Romans 3. Romans 3. I'm gonna use this because it's bigger. I know why you look back all the time, because it's much bigger and you can do that. Yeah. All right, so here we have Paul talking. Now, the purpose of the book of Romans, okay, he's writing to, pop quiz, where? Rome, yes, he's writing to Rome, particularly to the Jews living in Rome. But he's writing to the whole church body. But the point of the letter is, there are some Jews in Rome who are, simply put, they're full of themselves. And they have a misinterpretation of the role of the law. Okay, this is what's happening. We have Jews in Rome who basically think that, who see Jesus as a second Sinai rather than a second Adam. Jesus really isn't the lamb who is the sacrifice once and for all. He's the second chance. You know, with Jews, we haven't done really well in our history with obeying the law. But now with Jesus, we're really, really, really going to get it right this time. And how many times has God heard that before from the Israelites? But no, this is different, because we're talking about the Son of God, the Messiah came. We're really going to be able to keep the law and love it this time. And Paul's writing to them saying, no, you don't seem to understand. You seem to misunderstand what the law was all about in the first place. So let me tell you, he lovingly, like a good shepherd, corrects them. And so the question that he's dealing with here is, are Jews better than Gentiles in the sight of God? Because Jews were like, okay, so we had the law to begin with. God picked us out of all the peoples of the world, okay, and favored us. And the Messiah is Jewish. The Messiah comes through us. We have a privileged place. Right, it's as if Gentiles have a second tier salvation. It's the Jews, really, that have that foot in the door, so to speak. And that is what Paul is out to correct right here. So, anyway, Paul says here then, what then? Are we better? And I'm using the New American Standard just for fun. There are translations that, there are some that focus word for word, like what does this one word mean exactly in the English language? And then there are others that focus on phrases and try to get at the meaning. If you're ever looking for one where you need to know words, New American Standard is good. And I chose this in particular because of some of the words it uses. Anyway, what then? Are we Jews better than they, Gentiles? Not at all. For we have already charged that both Jews and Greeks are all under sin. As it is written, there is no righteous person, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks out God. They have all turned aside. Together they have become corrupt. There is no one who does good. There is not even one. Their throat is an open grave. With their tongues they keep deceiving. The venom of asps is under their lips. Their mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their paths, and they have not known the way of peace. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Wow. Thanks, Paul, for that encouraging, uplifting message. Well, there's something to what he says, okay? When he says, we have already charged, okay, that's referring to a subpoint he just finished arguing previous to these verses, okay? He's mentioning the existence of two laws in here. This is where I'm going to pause and say this is important. All right, you'll see a law with a capital L in here. Now, that refers to the what they call the Mosaic or the Sinaic law. That's just it's what happens when you put an ick on the end of Sinai, all right? It's the law, the Ten Commandments, and all the ceremonial laws that was given to Moses and the Israelites at Mount Sinai. But then there's law with a lowercase L, and that generally refers to natural law, okay? The law written on our hearts, the one that we know deep down, but that we resist. And this is, if you know, this is what Paul talks about in another place, how we resist that which we know deep down in our hearts. And so, it doesn't matter. This is why he's mentioning these two things. It doesn't matter which one you appeal to. Y'all still haven't kept it, Jews. You think that you have a first-tier place, a first-tier role, but you just need to look at your history and take a good look at yourselves. Okay, I don't care if you're appealing to Moses or you're appealing to creation. Either law condemns you. Okay? Observationally, we have broken the law. You can just look around and see. There's murder. Okay? We've done this, we've done that. So, okay, you've actually broken the law. It's written on your record. But what if you're a Jew like Paul before he converted, who kept the law to the nth degree? Right, his was a clean slate. Well, you can see it up there. Okay, observationally, they've broken the law, but introspectively, we are law breakers. Look at this. That whole thing that's in quotes there, that's just his compilation of Psalms, quotations from Psalms and one from Isaiah that he's just put all together. You know, it's like, you want evidence? You want evidence, Jews? You're all about the law? You're all about your Torah? Okay, let me give it to you. Let me give you some of the best. See if you've read it, because Paul had. Yeah, you think you're law keepers? Yeah. Look at this. Your own scriptures say otherwise. Okay. Inside, it's not just what we do on the outside. It's what we are on the inside, okay? And this is there's a heart issue at play. Jesus helps us understand this, right? When he's talking about, all right, hey, you say you've never murdered, you ever hated? You've murdered. Oh, look at you, you've been married to the same woman so many years, never had adultery. Wow, what a good husband. You ever looked at a woman lustfully? You've committed adultery in your heart, right? Doesn't matter what we look like on the outside, on the inside, there is something wrong. Even if you know that it's wrong and you can identify it and say, yeah, you know, that's my bad, you know, you can't miss it. There is a heart issue. That there's something fundamental about us that is really wrong. And this is exactly what Paul is driving at when he's got all these psalms, I mean, all these psalm quotes, that verses 10 to 12, there is no righteous person, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks out God. They have all turned aside. Together they have become corrupt. There is no one person who does good. There is not even one. Psalms 114, 1 to 3, and Psalms 53, 1 to 3. Verse 13, their throat is an open grave with their tongues. They keep deceiving. The venom of asps is under their lips. That's Psalm 5:9 and 140, verse 3. Verse 14 is Psalm 10:7. Their mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Verse 15 to 17 is Isaiah 59:7. Right? Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their paths, and they have not known the way of peace. And the cutting thing about Isaiah for the Jews is that most of those things are pronounced against them as a people. Most of what Isaiah or Jeremiah has to say is directed against the Jews themselves. Verse 18, there is no fear of God before their eyes, Psalm 36:1. So Jews, you don't have one foot in the door. If anything, you had what condemned you. And he's going to talk about this. Now, I forget whether he was a theologian or whether he was a scientist, but somebody once said, he was a Christian, he said, the doctrine of original sin, this idea, is the most empirically verifiable hypothesis there is out there, all right? Because you can live in the world for about, what, a year? No, a month? A week? And you've got all the evidence you need to prove that there's something wrong with man. And yes, it's worse than we thought. It extends even to the thoughts, right? Because the thoughts pit you against God's will for creation and betrays that at heart, you defy God. No matter what you say with your lips, at heart, you defy God. You don't have to follow through for it, or you don't have to follow through with a thought for it to count as a sin. Now, this seems harsh. They call themselves the new atheists. They call themselves the four horsemen of new atheism. And one of the most outspoken ones, maybe you've heard, Christopher Hitchens is one of them. He's spoken at a lot of events, like where they have a person of faith in a debate with the new atheists, and he's spoken at a lot of those. And this is one of the things that he most detests about Scripture and about Christianity. He calls this thought crimes, right? And he thinks it's one of the most abominable, he claims it's one of the most abominable things in any religion. This is ridiculous, he says. That a God would condemn you to hell forever or hold it against you for what you thought. I mean, we can't run a nation like that. What kind of God runs the universe like that? And it does seem harsh. It really does. Because all sorts of thoughts will come through your mind and you don't even know where they came from. But think about it. I mean, do you want men who have made verbal plans with each other, talked about how they're going to bomb the Mall of America? Haven't done it yet. They've talked about it. We're going to let them go free? We have evidence. We have recordings of them talking about it. Want them to go free? They haven't committed a crime yet. Haven't done it. Right, do we want somebody who's thoughts about people in the classroom? Want them to keep teaching? Haven't done anything yet. So you see, it gets scary. It really gets scary how deep this problem runs. And Paul is trying to scare these Jews off their high horse. You haven't kept the law like you've thought. Well, that's a cheerful message, Stephen. Thank you. I feel like going home now and worshiping the Lord. Okay. His point, though, is something they need to understand this. Because if you don't understand the bad news, the good news will mean nothing to you. And there are so many people sitting in the pews of churches today in America, well, across the world, who think they're okay with God. And so the message of the cross is empty to them. And they're just going through the motions. And they have no idea that at birth, they were pitted against God as an enemy. And that is the most dangerous position for someone to be in. It doesn't feel like it when you're living your life and you have a good salary and you have a nice home, a dog and a white picket fence, two kids, right? If life feels okay. But as one wise person once put it, your life is a vapor. And then what? That gets auctioned off to somebody else. And then it is appointed once for man to live, once to die. So it's scary. It's scary. Through the law comes the knowledge of sin. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be closed and all the world may become accountable to God. Because by the words of the law, none of mankind will be justified in his sight. For through the law comes the knowledge of sin. I said this in one of my devotionals. Look, the law doesn't reward you for being good. Who here is like, you know what? Especially after this year, I just am so proud of our government, and I am so in love with this, you know, that I just want to give double my taxes just as a gift to the United States of America, right? I've not only paid my taxes, but I'm going to give more. Anybody? I don't have enough to give double that, right? How about, you know what? Speed limit says 35. I'm going to go 30. I says, I'm just such a good law keeper right there, all right? Does the law reward you for, if you go slow enough, you'll get pulled over anyway. I wish more that would happen more often, but you are not going to get rewarded for keeping the law. That's not what the law is there for. The law is there to keep it orderly. The law is there to condemn you when you do wrong. You're not recognized at your funeral for having kept and given more than the law required. But if you are a lawbreaker, especially a consistent one, you'll be remembered for that. That's what the law does. And here the Jews had the wrong idea. They thought it was there to save them. It was there to show them the right path. Well, this, see, we didn't know exactly what to do. Now, since Sinai, we know, and we'll try to keep it. We failed, but, you know, we'll do better next time. Paul says, you don't get it. It was never there to save you. It was there to teach you. It was there to show you what you needed most. Cheerful. But it gets worse than that. And it has to get worse than that. And this brings me to what the main point, this is what I was getting at this whole sermon, is this next point I'm about to make. All right, Paige, can you pull up Romans 5, the Romans 5 passage, please? Yeah, this one. This one is a doctrine that is highly resisted and highly hated, even among Christians. Because it is not palatable, and it does not sit well in the heart or in the mind. Because Paul is like, hey, you know what? Yeah, I just got done telling you, you know, you've broken the law more times than you know. But the news gets worse than that, and it has to get worse than that if the good news is going to be any good. It's not just what we do, but what we are. All right. Verses 6, starting here. He's just talked about, in this section, if you're reading a Bible, you might have a header that says, the results of justification. All right, so Paul has, in chapter 3, he talked about the law, and talked about what the correct cure for having broken the law is. And he's talking about, okay, now in Christ, what we have is justification. Through Christ, not through the law. We are justified. We are declared right in God's court of law. Our record is signed off as righteous. That's what justification is. And he's talking about that. We'll come back to that because we can't get to the good news yet. We have to hear the bad news first. The results of justification, but he has to describe something else first in order for that to be meaningful. For while we were still helpless, okay, this I'm going to come back to that because this is something that a lot of people struggle with. While we were still helpless, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. For one will hardly die for a righteous person, though perhaps for the good person someone would even dare to die. Okay? That opener, for while we were still helpless, is what trips a lot of professing Christians up. We were never, if you listen to how Paul is wording it, while we were still helpless, we cannot help ourselves. We were never looking for God. We didn't exercise our free will and move towards God ever at any point in our pre-salvation life. We were helpless. lists in our defiance when he came to get us. But yes, yet we were worse. Look at next. But God demonstrates his own love toward us, and that while we were still what? Ooh. You sure about that, Paul? I mean, I know I've done wrong. Doesn't that, I mean, somehow that, I feel like I'm moving towards God. I'm not there yet, but surely I'm not a sinner. Like, that's, whenever in the Bible they use sinners, it's a pejorative. It is it's a term that you're ranking with the worst. They always put tax collectors and sinners together because IRS agents are, you know, have their own category. So, while we, Jews, Gentiles, Paul, were still sinners, Christ died for us. So we weren't just helpless, we were sinners. It's getting worse and worse by the minute. Well, what do we do, Paul? Now, verses 9 to 11, I'm going to read right now, but I'm going to come back to it, because this is part of the solution. This is something later on in this chapter he's going to nod back to, and so I'm going to come back to that, but I will read through it right now. Much more than have we have been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through him. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only this, but we also celebrate in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received the reconciliation. Now, I breezed through that, but I'm going to come back to it, because this is what theologians for a long time have called the Great Exchange. And later on, Paul is talking in accounting terms, in terms of exchange. And so he's going to nod back to this. And so I want to save it for later. I'm going to keep on the bad news for now. Just going to pump you up full of bad news. Verses 12 to 14. Therefore, just as through one man sin entered into the world, and death through sin, and so death spread to all mankind, because all sinned. For until the law was sin in the world, for until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not counted against anyone when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam until Moses, even over those who had not sinned in the likeness of the violation committed by Adam, who is a type of him who is to come. Now here's where it comes in, the news nobody wants to hear. All right? Just as through one man, sin entered into the world, and death through sin, because of one man. Now, harken back to Sunday school. Who is that one man it's talking about? Adam. This trips a lot of people up and makes them mad, and they try to reinterpret this or just skip over it altogether. Okay, think about it. Adam's the first man. He is humanity. Represented. He's all that there is at the time. Adam and Eve, that's it. They are your federal representatives of the human race. It says, death, which is the curse of sin, okay, death is the result of sin, was brought to the world through Adam. So he holds federal headship over us. All right? Look at how that works. Wait a minute. I didn't eat from the tree. I wasn't in the garden. So why do I get this death? Why do I get this inherited? Why do I get this sickness passed through me? I didn't do it. Paul says you did in Adam. You think you weren't there at Eden? You were. Adam was there. And there are a lot of people who claim that, well, if I had been there, that might be a different story. If I had just been the first man. Well, first of all, probably not. But second of all, you were there. Adam was representing you. He stood for you and all of humanity at Eden. It's not just, there was a crossroads, a fork in the road at Eden. So God created man and woman, placed them in the garden, but he gave them a choice. Now, oftentimes, we know the bad choice part of it. And we know the consequences of it. We're living with them now. But there was also consequences for choosing the right thing. Glorified life. Something more than what they were even then. See, we have this misconception that when Christ comes back, it's all going to go back to the way it was at Eden. It's not. It's not. It's going to be what it was if they hadn't done wrong. There is something more waiting for us, and Paul's going to get to that at the very end of the chapter, and that's part of the good news. That's part of the really good news, so I'm going to save that. People were breaking the verses 12 to 14. For until the law, sin was in the world, but this is where it gets interesting. Sin was not counted against anyone when there is no law. Wait a minute. Well, think about it. People didn't have the law pre-Sinai, did they? They didn't know the exact mind of God. They didn't have the Ten Commandments. So you could say that it was ignorance. Their law breaking was ignorance. And wouldn't it be fair that if they were ignorant, the law wouldn't be counted against them? It wouldn't be counted against them if they broke the law. I didn't even know what the law was, right? Makes sense. Now, I'm sure some of you are thinking, well, yeah, but they're still sinning. And that has to do with what the heart, you're still a lawbreaker at heart. But they can't be called lawbreaking yet. They don't have the law. So why are people still dying? Why are people still sinning? It's not counted against anyone when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam until Moses, even over those who had not sinned in the likeness of the violation committed by Adam. That's weird. We're not sinning, we're not law-breaking, but yet we're still dying. How does that work? This is literally what Paul is saying. Take a look. It wasn't counted against you before the law. Somehow we're still dying. How does that work? Your sin was not imputed. This is a word, he doesn't use it now, but he will later. It's one of Paul's favorite words, imputed. And what that's a accounting term right there. It means reckoned. Okay? In other words, it's charged to this account. Right? Your law breaking was not charged to your account before Sinai. We're still dying. Uh-oh. What if they're wrapped up in somebody else's sin? Adam's. Look, nevertheless, death reigned from Adam until Moses, even over those who had not sinned in the likeness of Adam. They are charged with Adam's sin. They may not be breaking the fifth commandment explicitly, because they don't know what it is, but they've broken one law, the one at Eden. Ouch. You mean, Stephen, that I'm counted as guilty for something I technically didn't do? Now, even at a Christian university, people don't like this because it sounds unfair. How many of you can at least assent? That sounds a bit unfair at the face of it. All right, we are all of us here are charged with Adam's sin as if we had been there. It sounds unfair, but even the people who hate it most realize this. I mean, if you think about it, this isn't a foreign idea. Just listen to some of the problems going on in culture. I'm gonna mention a sensitive one right now, question of race. Now, wait a minute. I wasn't an antebellum slave owner in the South. Why am I getting charged with all those crimes? Simply because I'm white? Well, kind of. It was the sins of a people that oppressed one. Now, you didn't exactly, you know, let loose the whip, but to the oppressor, or to the oppressee, it gets a little more deep. All right, the problem runs a little more deep, and it's hard not to see even somebody who wasn't alive in the Civil War as not wrapped up in it. It gets difficult, all right? How about, so in my days in Ireland, it's a bit of a long story, well, Northern Ireland, There's been a lot of troubles over the past few decades in Northern Ireland, and it has to do with England having been once a colonizer of Ireland and Ireland wanting to be free. Ireland is free now, but Northern Ireland is not, but there are still people in there who wish it was. And they were oppressed because of their class. And for decades now, there has been bloodshed in Northern Ireland simply because people are Protestant, that is English, pro-England, or Catholic, pro-Ireland. And it is, you can feel it. I walk the streets and you can feel the tension. You can feel the tension. That person's Catholic. Never met them before. If you've never met the person, yet you're making a judgment about them. So this isn't a foreign idea to be held responsible for the sins of former generations. I think if we really think about it, we get it as the human race. We get the idea that Paul's driving at. It carries on. We are guilty in Adam. So it's not just original sin that's the problem. It's also original guilt. So it's not just your own sins. All right, now let's suppose, just for the sake of it, Adam had, I don't know, he was except from Eden, he was there hoeing his corn there, and he hit his foot, and he let out an expletive. Okay, there you go, he was vulgar. Now that's a sin. You're not charged with that because you didn't do it, right? That makes sense. You'll be charged with your own expletives, right? I'm sure there are many that have been tossed around here. No. However, you are charged with choosing the tree of the knowledge of good and evil instead of the tree of life. So it's original sin and guilt. That means, you see what that means? That means that before you were even born, there was no possibility of you having a choice to choose God. What that means is you weren't just born with a propensity to do evil things, which you were. That means you were born an outlaw. There's a film, it's The Princess of Thieves. It was young Keira Knightley in it. The premise is Robin Hood and Marion had a daughter. Right, and she has to live as a fugitive. Why? Because her father's Robin Hood. He's wanted in all of England. Well, she didn't rob the rich to feed the poor. Why is she being held accountable? Because she's the child of Robin Hood, of Robin of Locksley. She doesn't get the chance to be on the right side of the law because her parents are not. Ouch. We're all outlaws, as well as lawbreakers. Not good news. How many of you think that's just lovely news? Let's go home and have Sunday dinner now. Yep, all right, that's really all I had to say today. Thank you for coming. No, that would be terrible. It would be really terrible of me to leave you there. Paul brings us there, though, and there's a reason. He's continuing on this theme, but the gracious gift is not like the offense. For if by the offense of one the many died, much more did the grace of God and the gift by the grace of one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many. This is where he starts getting into the good news, but let's recap here, right? You're not, just take a look. Just take a look, everybody. I don't care if you're Jew or Gentile. You've broken the law, and this doesn't take any special insight to look. All parents know this. All parents know that man is born sinful, right? Right. How many times have you, you're putting the child to sleep, putting the baby in the crib, everything seems fine, and you dare to walk out, and you get back here, Mama, right? Because it is not time. You can't do anything, which he has not decided first. Get back in here. Bill Cosby said it best. This is why I had to borrow this. I wanted to insert some humor even during the bad news. But Bill Cosby says it best. I just thought of this before I began, right? But it's very easy to see that man is born sinful, isn't it? There it is. I didn't have time to put it up here, but I'll put it up here so you can hear it. You're not going to see the audio, or you're not going to see the visual, but you'll see the or hear the audio. This is how easy it is to tell. Man is not born good. We'll see if this works.
My skin is...
No, that's an ad. I don't want that.
Custom care.
That's what
your hair needs custom care. Maybe.
Everything she wants... She thinks it's all right just to take it. Well, sometimes it belongs to someone else. So the others say, give this back. This belongs to me. And the three-year-old says, mine! 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 And this sound travels through the house. And the vibrations seek out a grown person's spinal cord. And it makes the legs go up and down. And you have to get up and find out where the sound is coming from.
Mine! Mine!
And you see this child pulling on something and yelling, mine! Mine! And at the end of it is an older child mumbling, no, you got this out of my room. And you go up quickly and you...
Amen. Any parents in the room who can get an amen from, yeah? Hey, but parents, you're guilty too. This isn't a chance for me to just take out my aggressions on certain two people in the room. But I cannot confirm or deny that anything said. Well, but you do it too. How many times have children just been you're about to go on vacation the next morning, and you've heard guffawing and hooliganism in the room upstairs? Ka-thunk, right? And you've heard, shut up, you're not going. You won't make it to 16 if you don't shut up. They're just having fun. What's wrong? It's because in your system of law, which you got from the book of Hesitations, chapter 4, there shall be no parenting after 10 o'clock p.m. That's right. It wasn't actually any concern about them doing anything law-breaking, you know, they're not breaking the law. They've just started acting up after 10 o'clock. They've broken your law, gosh dang it. There is something in it. We laugh, and it's good to laugh, because laughter often is the best way to see our faults. There is something wrong within us from the start. And it's not just that we tend to do bad things, it's that we are a bad thing when we're born. All right, Paul, give us good news now. Yes, sir, he says. But the gracious gift is not like the offense. No, wait a minute. I got to turn the page now. So we got the diagnosis. What's the prognosis? Complete redemption. Provided by the second Adam. Look at this. But the gracious gift is not like the offense. For if by the offense of the one many died, i.e. Adam, much more did the grace of God and the gift by the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow to the many. There is a free gift being given out. Okay, now how many of you have gotten a free gift before? Something free. Now, there's always one person in the crowd who will point out, rather truthfully, that, well, there's nothing that's actually free. I'm sure some of you have owned a shirt, freedom is not free, right, before in your life. And there is some deep truth to that. It may cost you nothing to get that t-shirt, but as dutifully pointed out by some, you know, social activist, that shirt was made by children in a sweatshop in Indonesia, right? Nothing is actually free. It may be free for you, but somewhere there's cost. All right, so Paul's talking about a free gift here. All right, well, what's the gift? Let's look at the accounts. Let's look at the ledgers and see where the cost was. And to do that, you'll have to look back, Could you go back to verse 9 to 11? All right, this is where the great exchange comes into play. Much more than having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through him. For if while we were enemies, did you catch that? While we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Okay, look at the while. Okay, it wasn't while you were thinking about being a good Christian. It wasn't while you were saying, well, you know, maybe there is something to this. It's while you were pitted against God, kicking and screaming and defying him, shaking your fist. He came and justified you. You hadn't even given your assent yet. But you give it now. Amen. Yeah. Right? And look at this. This is another thing people have trouble with. Peter had trouble with it. Oh, you're not washing my feet. No. No, this is the wrong way around. You ain't doing this. Let's skip this foot washing thing, Jesus. Let's go right to Jerusalem. Get it done. Let's bring the kingdom. Let's go. Woo! And Jesus says, sit down, shut up, and I'm gonna wash your feet. We don't like to be receivers because we weren't created to be receivers. We were created to be doers in the garden. So we don't like to be receivers, but look, somewhere. Where is it? Where's the word received? Yeah, there. Okay, no, it's not there. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of the Son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only this, but we also celebrate in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received the reconciliation. Here is the good news. You may have a propensity to do bad things. You may be an outlaw from the get-go, but it's not about what you do. It's about what you receive. It's about what you receive. It's not your righteousness we're looking at now. It's an alien one. Where did this come from? I wonder. Let's read a little farther. But first, there's more. A reconciliation. Okay, that word in the Greek derives from the word for exchange in Greek, katalasso. Okay, it means to bring back into favor. Oh, that's sort of the meaning of the word there. In English, the word comes from the Latin to make friendly again. That's literally what it means. Reconcile. It means to make friendly again. Somehow, through this free gift, through this exchange, we've been made friendly with God again. How does that happen? We're credited. We're credited with something. What is it? His righteousness. Our debts are paid. And not only that, but our account has received a mysterious donation. And we can spend that money and make interest now. You see, before, all we had was debts. All we had was minus thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars. But now, it's a bit different. All right, go back to the next slide. Why is it different? Well, because there's something else. I'll just go ahead and read this. All right. The gift is not like that which came to the one who sinned. For the one hand, judgment arose from the offense, resulting in condemnation. But on the other hand, the gracious gift arose from many offenses, resulting in justification. If by the offense of the one, death reigned through the one, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. So what happened here? What's this great exchange? This is why the doctrine of original guilt is so important. Distasteful as it is, we need it. Because if we don't have it, the good news isn't as good as it can be. Because if there is no original sin, here's the deal. If you are not guilty in Adam, then you are subject to every sin, every new sin that you commit every day of your life. And if you die right after committing said sin without having made amends with God, then you will be subject to his judgment for that sin, even if you had faith in Christ. If there is no guilt in Adam and you're just charged with your own sins that you commit every day, then the sacrifice is only good, the sacrifice of Christ is only good every time you accept it again. Now, how many of you have accepted Christ and still sinned afterwards? Wow, well, we got a lot of good Baptists in the room here. I guess I'm not a good Baptist. If there is no guilt in Adam, then, I mean, you can be, like, if there is no guilt in Adam and you're driving down the road and somebody really makes you angry, you roll down your window and point them to Jesus. And then you run into a tree and die after that, then you're going to be standing before God accounting for that. Because you just, by that sin, you made the sacrifice of Christ worthless. You didn't have a chance to accept it again. Uh-oh. That's bad news. Folks, there are people sitting in church all over the world who are living under that pressure every single day of their lives. Because they are looking at what they are doing and how they don't measure up. And they're not looking to him who was enough. There are people who are beating themselves up and are scared to death because they know that there's something wrong with them. But they don't understand that this sacrifice that Paul's talking about covers more than they realize, because they haven't been told the full story. If there is no guilt in Adam, you are subject to every new sin you commit. But if we are guilty in Adam, then all we need is a new Adam to come and get things right where the first one failed. And I'll let him be my representative instead of the first one. You know what that means? I'll tell you what it means. It means that it is as if I had no guilt in the first place. It is as if we had done right in the first place. Oh my goodness. It's not just about the little things I do. This is taking care of who I am. Because we have a second Adam here. The first Adam said, no, I don't think I'll do this whole obedience thing. I think I'll just do it my own way. And we've inherited that, and we do things our own way. But there's a second Adam that came. Amen? And he did everything right. That's what we need. We need a second Adam. Second Adam, did he take care where the first one failed? Thankfully, God is God, and he can figure out how to do that. Virgin birth. He was born of Mary, not born of Joseph. So he was born of Adam, and yet he wasn't. In the genealogy, but he didn't receive that guilt. He wasn't born of Adam. Thank you, God, for figuring that out. Didn't receive the sin, so he didn't sin. Wasn't an outlaw from the start. He was like Adam was at the beginning. Went through the trials, did everything right, pleased God infinitely, and then, out of pure love, submitted himself to be the sacrifice in our place. And it's not just that you put your sins on him and they get accounted for. That would be good enough. It's not just that. There's an exchange going on. There's a two-way exchange. This is what makes it so beautiful. There's a two-way street here. He gets our guilt, and it's taken care of right there. But we get his righteousness. What? I get something I didn't do? That's right. Because God said, you know what? I created you to be with me. You mess that up, I ain't going to let you. I'm coming back. I'm coming back, and I'm going to make things the way it should have been. And nothing's going to stop me. How do I do that? A bloody cross and an empty tomb. This is why Paul says in another, listen, if there's no cross, if there's no bloody cross or empty tomb, forget this. Eat, drink, and be merry. tomorrow we die. What the heck? I forget this. And this is the Jew of Jews. Okay, this is Paul talking. Okay, this is the most Jewish of Hebrews you're ever going to meet. And he's willing to revoke his Jewishness if there is no bloody cross or empty tomb. He says, if this isn't how this works, then forget this. Forget this law keeping. It doesn't do any good anyway. It just shows me how bad I am. It just condemns me. Forget it. If all I have is the wrath of God coming, then I might as well have 50, 60, 80 years of bliss, and then come what may. But if there is a second Adam who came out of pure love and sacrificed himself in our place, that changes everything. It changes everything. If we trust in him, if we ask him to be our representative, not our first father, if we ask him to be our representative, then we are fully restored, not just to where we were in Eden. Like Dennis has said this before, actually, that whenever God restores, he doesn't just bring you back to where you were, he brings you back to where you would have been if you had never gone wrong. And this is where the news gets really good. Look at this. Look at what's being exchanged here. Verses 16. The gift is not like that which came through the one who sinned. For on the one hand, judgment arose from the one offense, resulting in condemnation. But on the other hand, the gracious gift arose from many offenses, resulting in justification. Through Christ, we have traded condemnation for justification. We are declared right in God's eyes. Verse 17, for if by the offense of the one, death reigned through the one, much more will those who receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. We have traded death for life. Verse 19, So then, as through the one offense the result was condemnation to all men, so also through the one act of righteousness the result was justification of life to all mankind. As if you didn't get it in the first place, Paul wants to reiterate. You've traded condemnation, a rap sheet, a 6,000-page rap sheet, for none at all. For as through the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one the many will be made righteous. It gets better and better. I've traded in my rap sheet for a clean one. I've traded in death for life, and I've traded in my identity as a sinner for one as a child of God. I have gone from outlaw to an adopted child. What kind of good judge, if he's going to be good, does that, except one that is crazy in love with those whom he made? This is why it's so important. I mean, if we, well, now I lost my place, gosh dang it. Oh, no, wait a minute. No, I didn't. I was at scripture. Okay, so we've gotten better and better. We've traded in everything. We've gotten a new identity, and this is where the news gets really, really, really good. For the law came in so that the offense would increase, but where sin increased, grace abounded all the more. So that as sin reigned in death, so also grace would reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. You see, he's not just bringing it back to Eden. There is something that's going to happen when he comes back. He's going to make it like it should have been from the beginning. If Adam had chosen the right path, that's where he's going to be. He said, this isn't good enough. I want eternity with you, not just this life. So I'm going to come back, and I'm going to herald in a new age. Huh, Jim? You know, I've talked about this before, a new age where there will be no mine. There will be no death. There will be no condemnation. There will be no identity amnesia where we don't know who we are as children of God. You will be a child of God forever and worshiping him like we always should have been. And the world will be whole again. That's the cure right there. The second Adam is a whole lot better than the first. Look to that, Adam, not to yourself. That condemns. Don't look to the law. It condemns. Look to a bloody cross and an empty tomb. Because that is how we are made right with God. I want to close. Well, how am I doing on time, Sarah? Yeah? She told me she's going to have a timer. I wanted to close by reiterating something. It's one thing to hear it, but it's one thing to know it. It's another thing to know it. This isn't just hearsay or theory. This is a done deal. It happened in history, and the prince of the air himself can't reverse it. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor height, nor depth, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. See, the joke's on Lucifer here. He thought he was fouling up things when he tempted Judas to betray Jesus, when he got the Jews to incite Pilate to put Jesus on that cross. He was like, ha! Oh man, it's my goal to outsmart God, and look, I did it. He shot himself in the foot. He can't undo history. It's done. The cross is bloody and there is an empty tomb. It's been recorded. People saw it. It happened, and it cannot be reversed. It's not a question on how you feel on any given day. How you do? How's your performance today? Are you feeling like a good Christian? I'm going to say this especially to our young people here. Was any millennials or Zoomers in the room? I don't see any alphas in the room. Yes. To those three generations in particular, because we are living in a culture today that insists that reality is what you create, what you feel inside yourself. That you are what you feel, what you think. But it's good to hear that reality is outside of us. This cannot be undone. It's not about how I feel. I may feel like this isn't a truth for me, but that doesn't mean it isn't true. You don't make him savior of your life. He is savior of your life, no matter how you feel about it. You don't make him savior on the basis of the ardency of your faith. Why would Christ tell us that the faith of a mustard seed could move the mountains if that were the case? He is your savior once and for all, because he undid what the first Adam did. So embrace him. This is where you just enjoy him. It is the object of your faith, not your faith itself, that seals the deal. That's why we say grace through faith. Now, one of the things that made me got me here to this message was a song that I really love. It's actually relatively new, but when I heard it, I fell in love with it immediately. And I didn't want to mess with putting it up here and all that, so I just thought I'd read you the lyrics, because it sums it up, and it's just amazing. And I really love hymns or worship songs that allude to moments in Scripture. Dennis, when you were preaching last week about the 99, there's this one called Reckless. Sheila, do you know Reckless? Right, when they even mention, this is the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I love songs that do that, because you are tapping into a richness, of themes that run from Genesis to Revelation that are there to point us to the empty tomb and the cross. And so I love it when that happens, and there's times in here. Another in the Fire, it's called, which that's the story of your shack, my shack, and a bungalow. Right? No. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. I'm sorry, Marge. That's just your husband for you. All right. There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Oh, and by the way, the fire referred to here, it's not just trial. It's not just trial, it's also judgment. When John the Baptist talks about fire and water, being baptized by fire and water, he's not talking about spirit and then, you know, he's not talking about baptism and then the spirit. He's herding the sheep, the saved and unsaved. But there is a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, did you catch that? I know I will never be alone. It's not a called off. The deal isn't called off when you don't feel like it. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the waters holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free, not how I might be set free, how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There is another in the fire. All my debt left for dead beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. And should I fall in the space between what remains of me, what my old self, and this reckoning that happened here at Golgotha, either way, I won't bow to the things of this world, and I know I will never be alone. There is another in the fire standing next to me. There is another in the waters holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding what power set me free, there is a grave that holds no body, and that power lives in me. And I can see the light in the darkness as the darkness bows to him. I can hear the roar in the heavens as the space between wears thin. I can feel the ground shake beneath us as the prison walls cave in. Nothing stands between us. Nothing stands between us. There is no other name but the name that is Jesus. He who was and still is and will be through it all. So come what may in this space between all the things unseen and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There will be another in the fire standing next to me. There will be another in the waters holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding how good you've been to me, I'll count the joy come every battle. Because I know that's where you'll be. Amen? Amen. I guess that's all she wrote for me. So. Although you are in luck, because we have a printer at home that some people will just randomly, they'll print things off and then leave them in the queue there. And so when I printed this off, I grabbed the whole bundle. And so I have a BLT pasta salad also to preach to you from the book of Comestibles, chapter 6. But I'll save that for another date.